The UK is always in the business of coming up with something very novel to sometimes compensate for a shortcoming. And that's true for any country. But when it comes to innovation and technology investment, the criticism is that the government has historically not done as much. The Cameron government did amp that up and try to increase the amount of money going into it. It was part of the SDSR in terms of the Strategic Defense and Security Review. Talk to us, though, a little bit about whether outthinking can match, especially in a post-Brexit world, an EU that is the third largest tech investor in Europe, a United States that is driving forward with an innovation initiative. It started in the Obama administration, but Defense Secretary Mattis and the Trump administration has embraced it. Is this outthinking going to be able to allow UK industry and government to be competitive in this highly technological world that we're going to see in, say, 5 to 10 years?
Could do, definitely. I'll give you an example. Everybody here is talking about space, space-based sensors, space-based communications, integration of space data, etc. Just suppose, instead of launching an expensive satellite, you had a high-altitude pseudo-satellite, a solar-powered UAV with a very large wingspan with ultralight sensors on it that can stay airborne for months. That is one of the programs we're running in the Defense Solutions Center.
Would it be like Airbus's Zephyr, for example?
Exactly Airbus's Zephyr, but the sensors came out of our innovation challenges, and particularly things like the optical sensor, which a tiny university spin-off who had been working in static optics for the telescopes for the space industry were able to miniaturize and get the performance into something like Zephyr, which is, this is the whole point about being able to outthink. And yet the effect in terms of your ISR picture is just the same as if you had a very expensive satellite up there. So yeah, the outthinking part is important, but so is removing duplication. So for some years now, we've been working through the European Commission into the EU programs on research and technology, and in particular, this current period, 2015 to 2020, known as Horizon 2020. Initially, the world was a bit of a different place in 2015, but gradually the recognition of the way in which the geopolitical situation is going has started to make the EU consider that the next phase of research, 2020 onwards, needed to include defense capability. And to do that, you do sort of pilots, trailblazers, which they call preparatory action in Eurospeak. And that preparatory action is in place now. And UK has played a very big part in determining the agenda. So that then will lead to full-blown programs. And the Rome summit back in June of this year articulated exactly the size of that investment. It's 500 million a year. That is significant. And that makes the EU the third largest investor in defense R&T in Europe.
What happens, though, in a post-Brexit world? And are there plans at all by the government, which, right, the whole bumper sticker for Brexit was £350 million a week is going to Brussels. Let's re-spend that at home, whether on the National Health Service or, at the time, reporters were covering it and were saying that is way more optimistic. I'm not going to get into the numbers and the figures, but is there a sense from you about how much defense investment is going to come toward you in a post-Brexit world where you're not going to benefit from Horizon 2020, for example?
The government has determined that we will continue to stay in the in those research programs. I mean, not only from the point of view of the sense that it makes for defense, but also because our university systems, and you know, it's not by accident, you have five of the top research and teaching universities in technology and engineering here in the UK, but the whole research ecosystem is pan-Europe, so huge numbers of European academics come and work in research teams here, and vice versa. And it is sensible not to break that apart. And the universities themselves have been pointing that out. So, you know, if this actually does become enshrined in UK policy, which I expect it to, then that's a good thing.
Let me ask you a budget question as our final question. A lot of very ambitious UK defense plans, whether it's the acquisition of P-8 maritime patrol aircraft to replace the Nimrods. Those planes were scrapped, even though it was an enormous effort. You were there at the time when that happened, at least when the program was going through its challenges. P-8s, Apaches, a lot of direct acquisition from the United States, but a lot of also key technology development, Type 26 frigates. The Dreadnought program is up and running. There are two aircraft carriers. The second one was named just last week, big deck aircraft carriers, and a very ambitious Joint Strike Fighter buy, which was going to constitute both the striking arm of the fleet air arm, but also key part of the RAF force. Those numbers were dialed back, or appear at least appear that they may be dialed back. Talk to us about the £30 billion gap now. It's in the Cabinet Office. The Times has done some terrific reporting on that. Talk to us about what the potential implications of this are, not just on the Royal Air Force, but across all of British defense capability.
Yeah, I mean, I can't validate the £30 billion, the position of the program or whatever, but there are some things that are certainly truisms. The first is, you know, you've recited a number of defense capabilities that are purchased in dollars, and the exchange rate has slid, so that's one aspect. Second aspect is SDSR 2015 had some ambitious savings measures in it for reduction in civil service numbers, for disposal of defense estate. You know, they're both challenging targets, so it wouldn't surprise me if the Director General of Finance were to say to us, appear to have a bit of a short haul here. You know, we've been, we're used to this. We make heroic assumptions at an SDSR, but as von Moltke said, no plan stands contact with the enemy. There is quite rightly a review going on, Cabinet Office led, which is not so much about making difficult choices in defence, although I've no doubt there will be some, but it's understanding how we should use the total budget applied to the nation's security. So the agencies, to a certain extent, Department of International Development. So just looking at the way our priorities should be, given that security is a multifaceted thing, and you can't these days isolate defense from the other aspects. So I guess there will have to be a bit of rebalancing. How draconian that's going to be, I couldn't say till I see the numbers.
Right.
Sir Brian Burridge, thanks so much for spending so much time with us, and best of luck on the initiative, and we look forward to maybe coming out there to Farnborough and visiting with you guys.
You'd be very welcome. Good to see you.